Treatment for a bradycardic rhythm depends on whether or not there are serious signs and symptoms. In our scenario, you're the ACLS team leader for a 78-year-old female patient. The patient is pale and diaphoretic. She tells you that she feels dizzy and weak. She states that she started feeling this way about 3 hours ago and it's been getting worse. Now, because the patient is conscious and alert, we can pretty much say that she's stable at the moment. But since we do not have any immediate life-threatening conditions, the first step is going to be getting a set of vitals. So you direct your assistant to check the vitals, and they tell you that the patient has respirations around 20, heart rate of 48, and irregular. The blood pressure comes in at 78 over 40 with an SpO2 or pulse ox of 94% on room air. Based on these vitals, you would not need oxygen right away, but the patient is obviously bradycardic and hypotensive. In order to know if the hypotension in bradycardia is related to a heart arrhythmia or other cause, we should get an ECG reading. An assistant attaches the ECG monitor so we can take a quick look at the rhythm. As we look at the monitor, we see narrow QRSs. We also see a regular P wave until the QRS is dropped. We recognize this rhythm as second degree type 2 heart block. But because this type of heart block is below the bundle of His, it can turn into a complete heart block fairly quickly. The hypotension in bradycardia is a concern, so we direct our assistant to start an IV so we can consider giving atropine. If the patient was unstable, such as being unconscious or pulseless, you'd want to start with transcutaneous pacing. But since our patient is responsive, we choose atropine first. You direct the assistant to give 1 milligram of atropine rapid IV push. The assistant repeats the order and gives the medication. After about a minute, we recheck the vitals and find that the respirations are still 20, heart rate is around 46 and irregular, weak, and the blood pressure has not improved. It's still 76 over 40, with a pulse ox still reading 94%. Now, based on the vitals, it looks like atropine was ineffective. The assistant tells you that the heart rate and the blood pressure both went down, and the patient just became unconscious. Now we have an unstable bradycardia. We need to start transcutaneous pacing right away. We directed the assistant to apply the pacing pads and turn the pacer on. Protocols will vary from location to location. However, the American Heart Association guidelines recommend that we start at a rate of 60 beats per minute and adjust the rate up or down based on the patient's clinical changes. As the pacer is running, we turn up the milliamps until the heart muscle is captured. In our scenario, we turn the pacemaker up to increments of 5 milliamps until we have consistent capture at 70 milliamps. We then turn up the milliamps to 75 to retain capture. Once you have consistent capture, we're going to adjust the rate to between 60 and 80 beats per minute. Remember, you can turn that rate up or down until symptoms improve. In our scenario, we turned the rate up to 68. We see that the patient became responsive again. And upon checking the vitals, we now have a respiratory rate of 16, heart rate of 68 with good electronic capture with transcutaneous pacing. The blood pressure is now 96 over 60 with a pulse ox of 96. Once the patient's perfusion has improved, we need to continue to monitor the patient. We work on improving perfusion by trying to determine the cause of the bradycardia and treating it accordingly. Now keep in mind, transcutaneous pacing can be very uncomfortable, so pain management may be something to consider while deciding to move them to the next step for cardiac treatment.